Welcome back to class. This is Module 6. This week we're going to be talking about mentoring being one aspect of our discipleship program. Mentoring primarily being that one-on-one interaction that you would have with a student for the purpose of guiding them towards spiritual growth, but addressing some specifics. So I wanted to walk through a few things about mentoring with you, and then I've got a special treat at the end of this that'll bring some of it home and give you some good clear application. First off, mentoring in and of itself is an incarnational ministry because you actually choose to enter the life of the student. It's not about them showing up at church and reading through a book with you or any of that type of stuff. It's about you getting with this student and entering his or her life by saying, here's what we're going to study, here's what we're going to do, let's talk about how it applies to your life. And then when you come back, we're going to talk about how you did during this since our last meeting. So it's one of those things that you really are able to get involved and find out what they struggle with, what their challenges are, and what their victories are as you invest in them. Mentoring in that respect is also a guiding type of ministry where we as mentors teach, guide, and direct our mentees from the perspective of Scripture and from our own personal experience, because we've been walking the life of faith longer than them. So we are incarnational, we are guiding, and then we are individual. For the most part, mentoring is one-on-one. You can, from time to time, do small groups, but for the most part, it's going to be one-on-one with a student talking about life. Now, let me put into play for you a couple things, though, because we do have safety issues to think about when we go one-on-one. If I'm going to meet with a student one-on-one for mentoring, I'm going to do it in a public place. I'm not going to be alone, even though I'm going to match up our students with adult mentors that are age-appropriate and gender-specific. We still don't want to put ourselves in harm's way. We always want to be above reproach and not give the appearance of evil. So what I recommend is if you're going to meet one-on-one with a student at any time, that you do that in a public place. If they're going to meet at the church, then meet somewhere at the church where other people are around. If it's in your office, make sure your door is open and other people are in the office suite. I recommend places like coffee shops, places outside the school, McDonald's, whatever it might be, where there's other people around, and that gives at least the feeling of accountability, and it keeps you visible to people who might come up and wonder what's going on. So it just takes away a lot of the questions and keeps everybody safe in the process. Now, specifically, what is our model for mentoring? Yet the word mentoring is not used in the Bible. Okay, there's a lot of words we use in church that are not used in the Bible. But our biblical basis for a mentoring program comes from Titus chapter 2. And Paul says to Titus, he's writing, he said, "You must teach what is in accord with sound doctrine. Teach the older men to be temperate, worthy of respect, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love, and in endurance. And likewise, teach the older women to be reverent in the way they live, not to be slanderers or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Then they can train the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind and be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. Similarly, encourage the young men to be self-controlled. In everything, set them an example by doing what is good. In your teaching, show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech that cannot be condemned, so that those who oppose you may be ashamed, because they have nothing bad to say about you." And he goes on at the end in verse 15 and said, "These are the things that you should teach. Encourage and rebuke with all authority, and do not let anyone despise you." And he goes on and he talks about slaves and masters and other things in this chapter as well. But the main thing we want to look at here is there is a command for older men to teach younger men, for older women to teach younger women. And we can take that and we can make that an age-specific thing, or we can talk about a maturity-specific thing. The point is, those of us who have more experience, more maturity, and have lived longer in this life of faith have a responsibility to share that insight and that experience with the younger generation. Now, in most cultures, older folks are looked up to. There is a level of respect you get just for being older. And in this culture, in the Jewish culture and in the Greek culture, that was definitely true. Today, we value youth so much that sometimes we forget that our elders have a lot to share with us. So mentoring is an opportunity for us to go back and rebuild that relationship that our students might have with their elders. And I encourage you, as you look at mentors, don't limit the age. Some of the best youth workers I've had over the years were grandparents who still loved kids. And they didn't do some of the things they used to do. They didn't listen to the same music, but they showed a genuine love for the students, and the students responded to that. Now, talking specifically again about mentoring. Mentoring and discipling are not the same. I was questioned by a colleague recently who said, well, why do you have a class on discipleship and a class on mentoring? Aren't they the same thing? No. As you learned in our last module, Module 5, discipling is about the entire process of spiritual growth and moving towards maturity. Mentoring is one aspect, okay, one tool that we have in that process, and it is specifically the one-on-one guidance. So it is a type of discipling. Mentoring is also a buzzword right now in the business community for business leaders to mentor younger employees that are coming in and guiding them forward and doing their job well. But we keep it in a very spiritual perspective here and make it a part of our discipling process. Now, you can, again, mentor somebody on non-spiritual matters. And sometimes you take things from an interesting approach. I have a young man I've been mentoring who initially came to me because he said, I need to grow in what it means to be a biblical man. He said, a lot of things have been soft. He said, I've realized I'm not as connected with a lot of guys as I need to be, and I need to do some study that brings out this power of manhood within me. And I said, well, great. And we picked some books, and we picked some Bible characters, and we walked through. We've been together for almost 2 years now mentoring. I've seen a lot of growth in that. But our initial process was to build up the man that God had created him to be. And now we've moved on to other aspects of life. So you can twist this thing in directions that are needed based on the needs of the mentee. But initially, ultimately for us in ministry, it is to bring him back to a place of growing spiritually. And everything in the life of a Christian is spiritual. There is no separate spiritual life. Everything we do is spiritual. Again, it's typically one-on-one, but the thing we want to get to here is, what are the outcomes? Just like any other program that we would design, there need to be measurable outcomes in our mentoring. I need to be able to say, okay, I'm going to meet with Joe, and we're going to read this book, and we're going to spend 6 weeks on it, and here are the things I want Joe to learn. By the end of this book, I want Joe to be able to tell me 3 things that have changed positively in his life. Or I want Joe to have memorized 4 scriptures within this. Or I want Joe to be bold enough to go out and share his faith with somebody, depending on the perspective or the point of our mentoring time. What this does, it allows us to stay on track. Too often, mentoring relationships fall into just drinking coffee together. You get together and you have a Coke, you have ice cream, a coffee, whatever it is, and you just hang out, and we lose our perspective on what we're trying to accomplish. By setting desired outcomes and then measuring them, we're able to evaluate the process and say, did we do what we came here to do? It's not about feeling guilty about things that we didn't accomplish, but it's about looking at how effective we're being, but also being able to look at the life of our mentee and say, I invested and I see growth. And that's what we're ultimately here for, is to see that growth. So make sure that every mentoring relationship that you start, you have measurable outcomes that you're looking for over a specific period of time. And I think usually in that 6 to 12 weeks time frame, because it doesn't get too long and drawn out, and you can remember what those outcomes and those desires are. Okay, the law of the lid. Now, this is a term from John Maxwell, one of his leadership principles. The law of the lid basically says that I can't lead you somewhere I haven't been. I can't teach you something that I haven't learned. I can't help you become something that I'm not. So when we select mentors to put with mentees, we have to make sure that that mentor is at a place of greater maturity and greater knowledge and greater experience so that they have something to share. Jesus told us that the teacher is never greater than the master. There's a place there that eventually, as humans, when we mentor someone, our desire is to eventually get them to that same place of knowledge and maturity that we are, and then we may have to hand them off to somebody else. But hopefully we are being mentored, and we're continuing to grow as well. And so there's this constant process of growth in both of our lives. Now let's talk specifically about adult mentors. I believe that the initial phase of any good student mentoring program is going to start with adults who will mentor students. Okay? Now, they may mentor them specifically just for the sake of just mentoring them for spiritual growth, or you may be using those adults to mentor students who will in turn become mentors to other students. But when we select adults, we have to be very careful. Now, your church may have policies related to background checks or any of that working with minors, and by all means, follow whatever process that is, because we do want to make sure we keep our students safe and keep our adults safe from weird things that may happen as well. But we want to make sure that we've got a couple of things in play when we look at adults. The number one priority, okay, is to find adults who love God and love students. Everything else can be learned along the way. But if this adult has a heart for God, and out of that heart for God, he or she has a heart for students and wants to love students and see them grow spiritually, then that is a prime candidate to be a mentor to our students. We can teach this person how to teach a Bible passage. We can teach them how to pray with somebody or how to lead them in ministry or how to actively listen. We can do any of those things if the heart is in place. So we have to make sure that we spend time with these adults and not just pick warm bodies, but actually think about who these folks are and how effective they'll be. And then we have to make sure we match them up with the right students so the personalities don't conflict. And again, we will go through with them the ability to communicate, to set goals, and to make sure they're specific with their appointments. One of the worst things you can do in a mentoring relationship is fly by the seat of your pants when it comes to setting appointments and working together. Well, when do you want to get together? I don't know, when do you want to get together? It makes me think back to a Disney movie where the vultures are sitting on the tree and they say, what do you want to do today? I don't know, what do you want to do today? We want to make sure that our adult mentors recognize that there is a place of authority as a mentor that says, we need to meet, we're going to meet, we've committed to doing this, here's a time, can you make this time? And you work with your schedule on that. But also, again, that we have taught them how to walk through the process and the evaluation and how to track and enter into the lives of these students. Now, that leads us to the next aspect of this, which is peer mentoring. This is teens mentoring teens. Now, you don't see as much of this, but we need to see more of it. Our adults need to mentor teens for the purpose of mentoring other teens. Now, Leighton Ford, in his book, Transforming Leadership, talked about something called the minority strategy. And he is addressing how Jesus discipled, his disciples, how he worked with the 12 in particular to equip them to do ministry. As your mentoring ministry grows, you can't meet with every mentor yourself. So you're going to need to have adults who oversee a team of student mentors. And the reality is, students respond better to older students than they do to adults. They're more likely to find common ground to discuss the things of life. And younger students like connecting with older students and having their attention. So this is a great opportunity. But just like when we are selecting adult mentors, we have to make sure that the student mentors are spiritually mature and that they truly have a heart for doing this mentoring ministry, not just so they can look cool or feel like they're a leader or have attention or an opportunity to boss somebody around. We have to be very careful with those things and make sure that we put students in the right place and pair them up with the right students so that they can work together correctly. Again, specific outcomes, training needs to go in. And another thing I believe with student mentors, we need to make sure that their accountability partner, their mentor, an adult mentor, meets with them regularly to mentor them, but also to check the progress of how they are mentoring their mentee. Because that's very important, because we don't want our mentors to get frustrated, and we don't want our mentees to get frustrated either. And there needs to be a place, if nothing else, a sounding board of a caring adult who can be that mentor to the mentors. And we have to develop that and have that into place for accountability as well as for productivity. Be careful of manipulation issues. Be careful of teens who might have ulterior motives. Know your students. Know the ones that you're putting out there in leadership to make sure that they're going to be doing things the way God would have them to do them. Again, I think teens respond very well to other teens working with them. I think it is more of a give and take when it's a mentoring relationship like this. We're not putting these students so much in a place of authority to boss this person around. We don't ever want to see that. But they are in a place for guiding and for caring and speaking into the lives of their peers so that there is a place in there of being able to grow and challenge and move forward. Now, the next part that we're going to do in our discussion of mentoring is I'm bringing in a friend of mine, Jared Allen. He is student minister at Willowbrook Baptist Church here in Huntsville, where my family attends, and I'm a volunteer under his ministry. Jared has set up a peer mentoring program here at Willowbrook, and he's going to come in and he's going to share a little bit of his heart and how he's put that together, And then I'm going to hammer him with a few questions afterward to help us get that together. Remember, this week, you've got articles to read. They are all focused on mentoring. And you have a mentoring program that you are to design and turn in. So be sure you include the principles that we've discussed and things you've learned from the reading and some ideas you may pick up from Jared's interview to help you build that in a way that will be effective to you. All right, guys, welcome back to Module 6. As we've been talking about mentoring this week, I want to take a few minutes to get real specific with you, and I've invited my friend Jared Allen, who is a student minister here at Willowbrook Baptist Church, where my family attends. He's the guy I trust my kids to. Jared has a great ministry set up in the high school ministry, which is a peer mentoring program, and I've asked Jared to come in this morning and talk to us a little about that, tell us how he set that up. So, Jared, why don't you tell us what's going on with this ministry, the birth of it, and what you're doing?
Absolutely. Well, the first thing I would tell you is I just felt convicted that I had become a student minister who was being the show. I was the one-man show. I was the one doing the ministering. And I know that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible says my job as a minister is to do what Ephesians 4:12 says, and that's equip the saints for ministry. I don't want my students just to experience ministry. I want them to be ministers themselves. And this is a very biblical thing. You know, we look at Paul and Timothy and how he was pouring his life into him. I think of like 2 Timothy 2:2, these things you have heard me say in the presence of men, also entrust to other reliable men who will also be qualified to teach others. And so I'm picking out qualified students. Now, I'm not just students, period. We want to make sure we pick out students who are qualified to lead others spiritually. And I want to challenge you guys. That's something you have to be really careful of there. You don't want to just grab any student with an outgoing, extroverted personality and label them a spiritual leader. You know, we need to make sure kids are walking with God before we put them up with another student and say, hey, basically be like this kid. So they don't have to live perfect lives, but they need to be spiritual leaders. So that's one big thing right there, picking out spiritual leaders to be a mentor. From there, I think of two big key words that I like to use, train and equip. A lot of times ministries fail with students being in charge of them because we as student ministers have not done a good job of training them. We have to do the legwork before we start a ministry if we want to see it succeed. So the very first thing I do when I find a student who I think could be a great spiritual leader, I start thinking in my head of who they could be a good fit for to mentor. And then I'm going to schedule a meeting with them, and we'll go to Starbucks, Sonic, whatever, and we'll sit down, and I'm going to go over some key things with them that I want them to understand, things that I might take for granted as a minister, but I want to make sure they understand before they step out in this role as a spiritual leader. One thing I would tell them is to be humble. You know, sometimes you give the title leader to a student, and they're like, oh, hey, look at me, you know, and they start, pride starts to creep in, and we know how this is as ministers. Sometimes that can happen to us. Hitting that right at the very beginning. Hey, remember, it's just by God's grace that you're being the leader in this relationship and not this other student. So that's a key thing right there. And then asking them to take seriously their role as a leader. And, you know, I ask students to start thinking about, you know, is there anything in my life that could be a stumbling block that this other student that I'm mentoring could look at me and say, oh, that's what being a Christian is about, because that confuses me, or I don't understand. You're my leader, and you do this. So asking them to think about, you know, what's on their Facebook page, you know, how they're acting at school, things like that, and then to have them evaluate their own life. Again, not being perfect, but realizing the high responsibility. We might even quote the scripture where teachers are held to a higher standard and make them realize that they're in essence becoming a teacher in this role. And then I like to make sure I pair them up with the right student. This is so essential. Let me tell you a mistake I've made as a student minister. I've paired up spiritual leaders with students in their very first time to mentor with a student who is a marginal attender or somebody we were trying to rescue from sin. That's a great thing to do. The Bible says one who rescues someone from sin covers, you know, it's an amazing thing, covers a multitude of sins when you rescue someone from the pit like that. But that's not a great idea for the first person a student mentors, because that's going to be a big challenge. They may or may not come to those meetings. They may or may not be interested in that type of discipleship relationship. So a good key point is in the student's first mentor relationship is to make sure they begin with a win, with a success. Find a student for them that is just itching to grow, that is just craves the word, is going to crave this type of relationship. So I'll take a junior or senior who's spiritually mature. I'll find a freshman or sophomore in our ministry, or maybe even a middle school student, who is just craving more of the word, who is consistent in their church attendance, who I can tell wants more. And I go to that student, that younger student, and I say, hey, I look at you as a future leader in this youth group. And man, let me just tell you, their ears just perk up. They're like, what? You view me as a leader? That creates a spark of interest right there. And then I say, hey, what about, would you be consider meeting with an older student just once or twice, once a week, or once every 2 weeks, for some type of extra Bible study or mentoring relationship? I have yet to have a student turn me down. For one thing, students love being known as a potential leader. They like that. They like to see that you are thinking of them and that you want to invest in them. And number two, I've met very few younger students who don't like to have the time and attention from an older student, an upperclassman. Very, very, very true. So I pair them up and meet with them for training with that older student. Let me give you a couple things I tell those older students. First of all, to be humble. The second of all, to be aggressive in scheduling your meetings with students. Let me tell you the type of peer relationships, mentor relationships that don't work. It's the kind of one. It's the kind that say, we really need to get together soon. Yeah, let's get together. I'll call you sometime next week. Let me tell you, those meetings rarely happen, because what happens the next week is they get busy and they say, yeah, we really need to get together, don't we? We haven't met in a while. And so I tell our students, our older students who are the peer mentor, you know what? Don't leave your meeting without scheduling your next meeting right there in the spot. You look at your calendar after you finish your meeting, you say, hey, when are we going to meet next week? And you put it on the calendar, you schedule it right then. Realizing teenagers' lives are busy and you might have to reschedule, but if a reschedule happens, I tell our mentors, hey, if they cancel a meeting on you, you say, well, when are we going to meet then? Let's look at the calendar right now. Because the kind of meetings that take place are scheduled meetings. You have to be intentional about this. And then I tell them to constantly communicate with their person that they're meeting with. If you only meet with your person you're mentoring, and that's the only time you talk with them, how much level of care and concern does that communicate, really? Come on. The kind of mentor relationships that are really successful are ones where there's constant communication, because communication, time, communicates love and concern. And so a student texting that other student and during the week saying, hey, I'm praying for you about this. Hope you're enjoying what we're reading. I can't wait to discuss God's word with you. Facebook messages like that. That is the kind of relationship that builds trust and is going to make those meetings go even smoother. So those are the things that we talk about. And then frequency. For us, we tell our students we'd like them to meet once a week, or at the very least, once every 2 weeks. And we like the length of our meetings to be about 30 minutes. You get in your meeting, you have, about 5 minutes or a little bit more of just catching up on each other's week, showing that you care about each other's lives, showing a genuine interest, and then moving on to whatever type of Bible study or discipleship program they've chosen. Let me tell you just a little bit about some of the discipleship models that we usually use. We usually try to gear our discipleship towards the spiritual maturity of the person that's being mentored. If it's somebody who's new to the faith or just kind of marginal in their application and their commitment to church, we're going to recommend maybe you just get together and you read a book together. Some of our students right now are reading Francis Chan, Crazy Love. Yeah. Great book. And so, those chapters are like 10 to 14 pages. And so if they're reading that in the course of a week, that's a very marginal commitment. Another reason I like using that type of book is Francis Chan, like a lot of new contemporary writers, they have websites associated with their book. And so it says, while you're reading the book, hey, why don't go to crazylovebook.com and watch this video? And so there we've introduced media with the discipleship, not just reading, but we're introducing media. And teenagers love visiting websites. They love watching videos online. So we've added a little bit of a cool factor to our discipleship there. Anything that helps is and works. So that reading a simple book like that, for what we do, we tell our leaders is, we like to explain every detail of what they should do. So that way there's no guessing. So we tell them, why not start out with tell their student, hey, read this chapter, underline three things that challenge you, and underline two things that confuse you. And so when they get together, there's no awkwardness of, hey, what'd you like in the book? I don't know, I kind of like the whole thing. It's like, okay, tell me the first of your three things that you underlined that challenged you. Okay, tell me the first of your two things that confused you. And so the mentor can affirm the things that challenge them and say, that challenges me too. That's a tough part of the Christian walk. Or the things that confuse them, they can say, okay, well, let's look in the Word of God and let's see what the answer to your question is. Or that confuses me too. Let's go talk to our student minister about that. So that's one option. Another option we use is for more spiritually mature students is actually just reading the Word of God and take the same model. Let's read a chapter in James every day this week, and I want you to underline, one thing that challenged you, one thing that confused you, and we'll get together and we'll share the things that challenged you and confused me. It's a great model, and it works. It doesn't take long, but the students are actually in the Word of God and not just reading a book about the Word of God. And that's preferable. If you have a student who's mature enough and who can digest that, but don't just go straight into that. If you've got a student who's new to the faith, don't throw something out there that's just straight meat when what they really need is milk at the time. Move toward that, but realize that it's okay to read a Christian book. There's nothing wrong with that, while challenging them to read the Bible in their quiet time. And then finally, I like to check in with my leaders. You know, that's the cool thing about being a leader of leaders and not just doing all the leading myself is I'm discipling about 30 kids right now, but here's how I'm not meeting with them. I'm meeting with about 6 kids that are discipling other kids. And so what I do is I don't check in with those 30 kids. I check in with those 6, 7, 8 leaders and I say, hey, tell me about this student that you're meeting with. How's that going? Tell me about, do you need me to order new books for you? Man, I'm going to make it as easy as I can for them. I'm going to buy the books. And there's going to be nothing to think about. When they tell me they're getting to the end of a book, I'm going to have their next book waiting on them. I want there to be no excuses on my part for their ministry failing or lacking success. I'm sorry, I know that was a little thorough response there.
That's exactly what we were looking for, though, because our students are looking for ways to begin this type of ministry, to do with it. So let me hit you with a couple questions.
Let's do it.
A couple of specifics, because they've sat through some lecture from me on what mentoring is, what discipling is, and the programming, and you covered a lot of that, but I want to make sure they got the points in. All right, when you're putting together a program for a student, do you set specific desired outcomes that are designed to be met in a period of time? Mm-hmm. How do you decide that?
Sure, that's a good point. That's something we could probably improve on. We teach our student leaders to do that, to meet with a student and they not only read a book, but to talk with them about their weaknesses in their faith. Are you having your time alone with God? How is your life at school? Are you honoring God with your behavior? How is your life at home? Are you honoring God with your behavior at home? And then to regularly, when they meet, after they've done their Bible study, their discipleship, to ask, okay, how have you been doing in this? And so we've added an accountability portion to that discipleship relationship. And every discipleship relationship should have that to some extent. Now, obviously, some discipleship relationships are mainly accountability and a little bit of Bible study. For us, we're the opposite. This is just what God's led us to do. We're mainly Bible study, discipleship, and a little bit of accountability. But you do however you feel led. But every discipleship relationship, if there's trust built, there should be some accountability built into that relationship.
Absolutely. Okay. Now, you talk about you pick different books, different things that go on. And do you check at the end of these time periods, say your mentor has finished a book, do you sit down with them and then say, walk me through the growth you've seen in this person you're discipling? Can you tell me changes, or at least go back and debrief with the mentor and be able to say, how did this experience go for this 6-8 week period?
Absolutely. I'm checking in with that mentor regularly, probably once a week. And so I'm getting progress reports as we go. But I love to ask questions about how the book went, you know, if it really hit the target with that student, or if it just wasn't a good fit. You know, we have all sorts of options. I tell you, there's a ton of different style books that you can use. You know, like I label books in different categories. Like Crazy Love, that'd be a book that I would just call a regular book. It's just chapters. But then there's other types of books that are reading with discussion questions built into the book at the end. That's a great style book to do. Then if you have a student that's a little further along in your faith, then maybe a workbook style book, where it's a little bit of writing, but mostly questions. So a little bit of reading, but a ton of questions about the reading, a workbook style book. So those are different models that you could use for based on where a student is. And so if a student is getting it and craving more, like we have some of our students that they frankly embarrass me with how much time they spend with God, because they challenge me. We have some of our freshmen that are spending over an hour of time alone with God every day, and so they can handle, those girls can handle a Beth Moore style Bible study, and they can handle something that has a bunch of homework to do. But then there's our other students that you know, their faith is strong, their commitment to God is strong, but they you know what? They're involved in every sport under the, you know, on the planet, and you know, I'm very happy for them to spend 15 or 20 minutes in their time with God.
Absolutely. All right. Now, what about the training you take them through? These mentors. Do you have a specific model you use for training them to prepare them for this?
I do. I have a sheet, and I'll share it with Lee, and we can upload it to your website, or you can view it on this video, possibly. But I have a sheet full of bullet points that we cover, and so when we have that Starbucks style meeting, a training meeting, I will typically meet with once or twice in training, and I will go through all those points, how to contact your student, being humble, how to pick the right type of Bible study, how to schedule meetings with them, reminding your students of your meeting, all those points and more. I'll go over that with them. And then also, I have an optional second meeting that I often do with students, and that is, we will do a mock Bible study related to discipleship meeting to show them how I want them to conduct the meeting. And so I will act as the mentor, they will act as the mentee, and I will actually meet with them, and I'll give them an assignment and say, hey, you read this chapter, I'll read this chapter, you do this and I'll do this, and we'll get together and we'll discuss it. And so it'll be a living example to them of what they could do with a student.
Okay. All right. I got two last questions.
Yes.
Okay. The first one is, when you get to the point that you have got more student mentors that you can meet with weekly, do you have a plan in place to make that transition?
Sure. Well, first of all, I don't meet with my student mentors weekly. I just converse with them weekly. I just talk to them. But yes and no. Yes, I hope we get to that point where I can say that I have more mentors than I can meet with and converse with, but I'm not to that point yet. But I hope I get there. I've just been doing this for about 6 weeks here in the high school ministry. I've done it before in other ministries, but be looking forward to that opportunity.
Well, a big thanks to Jared Allen for spending some time with us today talking about his peer mentoring ministry here at his church, within specifically his high school ministry. Now, you may not do everything the same way Jared did, and the things he does here at his church may not work exactly in your ministry, but there are principles you can take from that and some ideas that I think will really help you as you move forward. I will make sure that I upload that document that he has that he walks through with potential peer ministers, mentors in that, the questions he asks, the things he talks about, and expectations, because that'll be useful to you in your ministry, and it'll help you on the project you're going to do this week as well. I hope you were able to pull down some principles that'll help you with that. And let me encourage you, whether you start with one kid or 100 kids or whatever it might be, depending on the size of your ministry and the activity level of the students in it, I encourage you to find two things. One, find somebody to mentor you and guide you, but also find some student that you can mentor. And then probably it will grow from there, and I would encourage you then to begin learning to mentor adults. Mentor the adults who will mentor students, who will in turn mentor other students. It's an amazing cycle once it gets to going, and you will see great, great progress in the lives of your students. And they may not all take advantage of it. Matter of fact, they probably won't, but some of them will. And those who will benefit greatly, and you will enjoy being a part of that process. So my challenge to you this week, start looking for a mentor and start looking for a mentee. God bless you. Have a great week.